all in all, I think it's been a very fertile period of trying to experiment both with traditional and innovative approaches to international cooperation institutions. But at the end of the day, although, as I said, these efforts go beyond just the efforts of countries, countries are important. And in order to make these arrangements work, whether they're formal or informal arrangements, we have to have strong ties to the key countries and the key actors that drive these institutions. And for us, that begins with revalidating and strengthening our traditional alliance cooperations in both Europe, in this hemisphere, and in East Asia, as I mentioned, through our engagement through NATO, in Afghanistan, through the strategic concept and the like, in East Asia with Japan and South Korea, issues that are going to be very prominently in display in the coming days, and with traditional partners in this hemisphere, with Canada and Mexico. Those of you who recall, it's important to remember with President Calderon here today, that the president's first meeting with a foreign head of state was actually even before he was president, following the tradition of meeting with the president of Mexico, and that was followed shortly thereafter with his first foreign visit to Canada. But as I think has been clear, we've also made an effort building on those historic alliances to build stronger and newer ties with key emerging countries, beginning with the infamous reset with Russia, our new deepened engagement with China. Next week, the Secretary and Secretary Geithner will be in China for the second strategic and economic dialogue. With India, the following week, we will be holding the first meeting of our strategic dialogue here in Washington with India and with the other key partners like Brazil, South Africa, Egypt, Indonesia, and others. The bigger story, clearly, from our perspective on Iran, is the agreement that we reached among the P5 plus one, which really demonstrates the importance of our engagement and our working with key and systemic powers to be able to move forward. This has been a very deliberative process. There have been some who've been concerned that maybe this isn't going as fast as others might like. But I think what we've demonstrated is by investing in these relationships and trying to use the Security Council where possible, a traditional international institution, we are able to have quite a big impact. And I think it's no accident that we're beginning to see at least some movement from Iran in the face of the fact that the international community is coming together under U.S. leadership, but through the investment in our relationships and in these institutions to make clear that the international community is concerned about the Iranian program. And although the announcement coming out of the meetings in Tehran is clearly short of what we think is necessary under the circumstances, it's a demonstration of what happens when you mobilize the international community to bring pressure to bear. We're going to have to keep going down that track. We are continuing to move forward in our discussions in New York. But I think it really is a demonstration of, in this world, how important it is to get international cooperation, to try to use the institutions where they can be made to work, and the possibility that they offer of really achieving important results on an issue which is at the center of our agenda, which is nonproliferation. If you invest in these sustained arrangements, where you build the institutions, both formal and informal, and you build the relationships, you're not starting at scratch every time. This is not a pickup game where each time you're having to begin anew. You begin to develop common working patterns, methods of cooperating together that allow you to move faster. I mean, for example, I think our experience in working with the P5 on the North Korean sanctions last year on Resolution 1874 put us in a much better position to move more quickly to deal with the Iranian problem. As complicated as it is, we'd had the experience. We'd worked through a lot of questions about what are the different kinds of elements that might go into an effective sanctions regime associated with nonproliferation? What are the interests of different countries? Where might they be prepared to go? Where are they not prepared to go? These, you know, as the academics would say, these multiple game relationships are very important because we understand each other. We were able to be able to build a relationship across a variety of issues, and where one issue is very important to us, another country might be willing to do more because it's important to us, because they know that in a repeated engagement that we may be willing to deal with issues that are important to them. So I think that there's no doubt these are always going to be difficult. It's always easier to act by yourself, or even within our country, it's not always easy to act quickly. But the value is high if you can make it work. The proposal that was developed last October was not an answer to the fundamental question and our concerns about the Iranian nuclear program. Iran has been subject to a number of UN Security Council resolutions because of its unwillingness to comply with its obligations under the NPT and to the IAEA. that it has been not forthcoming about its activities, that it has conducted clandestine activities, that it has retreated from its own obligations to declare facilities, that it has declined to implement the kind of safeguards that the IAEA expects. So even if the terms of the original proposal were fully met, we would still continue to have concerns about the Iranian program. But we were also very clear at the time that the proposal was made last October that this was not something that was the beginning of a negotiation. This was supposed to be a confidence-building measure for Iran to demonstrate that it wanted to show some ways of addressing the concerns of the international community about whether this program was designed, as they claim, for entirely peaceful uses, against all these reasons why there's legitimate doubts about that. The fact that rather than simply saying yes, which was fully available to Iran, to agree to ship out the LEU in return for the fuel for the research reactor, just continues to create further doubt. So we don't see this as a platform for negotiation. We see this as an opportunity for Iran to build confidence. And we would hope that Iran was prepared to just, rather than qualify, caveat, begin, you know, say, well, we're prepared to talk about it. They are the ones who need to build confidence in the international community about their intentions. And the way they should start is with an unqualified acceptance of what was originally proposed and originally agreed by the Iranians back in October. This is a complex situation in which dealing with the challenge of nuclear weapons has to be seen in the context of the conflicts in the region and a question of broader security. And so what we support and what we are working with others to do is to try to create a context in which we recognize that in the broader set of objectives the president's made very clear, if you're going to live in a world without nuclear weapons, that applies everywhere. But at the same time, that realistically and practically, if we want to make progress, that it's important to address some of the underlying challenges and insecurities in the region, and that we can't disaggregate those completely. And what we have not been supportive of is the idea that somehow this can be done without reference to the underlying causes of concern there. And we hope that the parties in the context of the current RevCon and others, will have a practical approach to this that recognizes that we would all like to reduce the risk of both proliferation and certainly the use of nuclear weapons, but it has to be seen in the context of the particular and specific challenges of the Middle East.